Hello, everyone. Welcome to Friday Night Live. We hope you are ready for our speaker tonight to give us a really good message. Let us pray before we start. Dear Heavenly Father, please bless us as we start tonight. Please help us to help us be able to understand what we're about to hear. And please send your Holy Spirit to give us understanding for what Brother Bosco is about to share with us. Amen. All right, let us start with opening music. There's no video, so it's just sound. Get that real quick. All right, this is from our brother Noah Logan. Thank you so much for that, Noah. It was very beautiful. And by the way, the title of the song was The Prayer. All right, now we can move on to our next segment. Brother Basco, floor is yours.
Thanks so much for having me tonight, guys. God bless you all, wherever you are tonight, wherever you're watching from. We just pray that you guys had a great week and that you're as happy as I was when finally the sun started going down and I realized, man, Sabbath is about to be here and we're able to just rest for a little while, relax, and not think about all of, well, everything that life throws at us those other 6 days. So I hope that you're all doing well. Let's pray quickly before we get into our subject tonight, which is going to be a sermon titled Spiritual Dropsy. Sounds weird, but I think you guys will get it as we move through this lesson tonight. So let's pray quickly. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you again, Lord, for the Sabbath. Thank you for the privilege of knowing you in this way, Father God. To experience every 7 days, Father, this reminder, this memorial of your creative power and your redemptive power in our lives, Father God. And we know, Father, that we could no more redeem ourselves than we could than we could create ourselves. So we are so blessed, Father God, and so thankful to have this privilege, Lord, of knowing this truth of experiencing every 7 days, Father God, this constant reminder that without you, Lord, we can do nothing. So be with us tonight, Father God. Be with me, especially Father, as I share this sermon that you've put on my heart, Father God. And Lord, if only one person is blessed by this tonight, I just beg you, Father God, let it be me, because I need this sermon as much as anyone else. So speak to us now, Father God. We ask in your name. Amen. So the title of the talk tonight, the lesson tonight is going to be Spiritual Dropsy, and it's going to be taken from the book of Luke, chapter 14. Now, in the book of Luke, chapter 14, there's a parable called the Parable of the Great Supper. And the reason why I studied this, just for the sake of being transparent, is my church decided to go through the parables of Jesus and look for the love of God in the parables of Jesus. And something stuck out to me about this one. I'm not too sure why. I mean, there's other parables that Jesus told that were much more popular, like the parable of the prodigal son is or the Pharisee and the publican are two of my favorites, or even the parable of the 10 virgins is another one of my favorites. But this one kind of stuck out to me a little bit, so I decided to study it deeply. But anytime you're studying a parable, you have to look at the context in which that parable was given if you're going to correctly understand. Someone is saying terrible internet. Let me see. I turned my Wi-Fi off, hoping that I would have better service. I turned my Wi-Fi off, hoping that I would have better service. So it gets a little iffy, but if those issues continue, you guys let me know and I'll maybe try to move somewhere else in the house. I'm all the way on the far end of the house right now. So, anyways, as I was saying, anytime you're studying a parable, you have to look at the context in which that parable was given if you're going to correctly understand the parable. Otherwise, you can take a parable and pull some pretty kooky little ideas out of it if you don't understand the context in which it was given. So before we're going to read through the parable, but before we begin to pull the truth and the principles out of that parable, we're going to go back and study the context. So if you have your Bibles, go to Luke chapter 14, and we're going to start in verse 16. And for the sake of time, I'm just going to start reading, but just catch up whenever you get your find the verse. Luke chapter 14. And I'm going to start from verse 16, and I'm going to read all the way through, and then we're going to go back and study the context a little bit and then see what we can pull out of this text. Luke chapter 14, and I'm going to start at verse 16. This is Jesus. Then he said to him, "A certain man gave a great supper and invited many, and sent his servant at supper time to come to those who were invited. 'Come, for all things are now ready.' But they all, with one accord, began to make excuses. The first said to him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must go and see it. I ask you to have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to test them. I ask you to have me excused. Still another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and reported these things to his master. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. Remember that. That's going to become important a little bit later. The poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind. And the servant said, master, it is done as you commanded, and still there is room. Then the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you that none of those men who were invited shall taste my supper. Now let's go back to the beginning of the of this story to see what context was this parable given in. The parable of this guy, a wealthy landowner, creates this huge feast, and he invites all of his friends to come. And then when it's time for the feast, one by one, they all start saying, coming up with some pretty lame excuses as to why they can't be there. And finally, he tells his servant, go find anybody who can be in here, because the guys that I invited, none of them are going to taste my supper. Let's see what context this was given in to see if we can figure out what Jesus is saying here and why he gave this parable. So let's go back to Luke chapter 14, verse 1. And it says, now it happened as he went into the house of one of the rulers of the Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath, that they watched him closely. And behold, there was a certain man before him who had dropsy. Now remember, the title of our talk tonight is Spiritual Dropsy. All right. So where is Jesus? Well, he's in the home of a Pharisee on the Sabbath day. Okay. Is there anything wrong with Jesus being in the house of a Pharisee on the Sabbath day? Absolutely not. There's nothing to do. Actually a lot right with it. The book Ministry of Healing says that Christ's method alone will give true success in reaching the people, and that the Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. He showed sympathy for them. He ministered to their needs. He won their confidence. And then and only then would he bid them to follow him, after he had gained their trust, after he had developed a relationship with them. So he's in the house of a Pharisee on the Sabbath. They're breaking bread. And verse 2, which is key, says, behold, there was a certain man before him who had the dropsy. Okay, so who's with Jesus? He's in the house of a Pharisee. It's the Sabbath, and there's nothing wrong with that. He's mingling with them. He's trying to build trust. He's trying to build a relationship with them. What he's after is, obviously, he wants to save these people, but he's there to befriend them. We have no indication from the scriptures that Jesus ever turned down an invitation to go to someone's house to come heal someone. He just wasn't like that. He wasn't somebody who was ever so busy that he couldn't meet the needs of everyone around him. We have no indication that he ever turned down any kind of invitation, no matter who it was that it invited him. Okay, so why is he there? He's mingling with them, trying to develop a relationship. And with him are religious leaders, their lawyers, who are not always friendly with Jesus, but he's still there. Now, what's the situation? So he's there, and when I preach this sermon, I have a picture that I show, but the way these feasts were set up, so if you picture, you're looking at into a room, and there's a back wall and two walls on the side. The way these feasts were set up, so you would see a table along the back wall, and along the two side walls, there would be tables right there. And the host would sit in the middle of the table on the back wall, and the guests would sit around the host like that in order of importance, okay? In order of importance. They'd be sitting around like that, all right, with the host in the middle. If any of you have ever seen The picture from, I don't know, I don't remember who painted it, probably Michelangelo or one of these guys painted of the Lord's Supper, and it shows Jesus in the middle, although that table is straight across. These tables usually went in like a U shape, basically, with the host in the middle and all of the guests around. Now, verse 2 says, "And behold, there was a man, a certain man before him who had dropsy." There was a man before him that had dropsies. Now, the lawyers and the religious leaders, according to verse 1, are watching Jesus. It says that he went to the house of a Pharisee to eat bread on the Sabbath, and that they watched him closely, and before him is a man with dropsy. Now, what's that man doing there? There's no indication at all that he's an uninvited guest. You remember in another story, Jesus is at the house, ironically, of a Pharisee, also named, I believe, named Simon, and someone busts into the house while they're sitting there eating. And it was noted in the text that somebody came in and interrupted the supper. There's no indication that this guy who has dropsy, which is a very visible disease, is uninvited, and they're watching him. Okay. Why are they watching him? Well, if you go back to Luke chapter 6, it'll tell you why they're watching him. Luke chapter 6, starting at verse 6, says, "Now it happened on," listen to how similar this story is. "Now it happened on another Sabbath also that he entered the synagogue and taught, and a man was there whose right hand was withered." So, similar situation. Jesus is teaching or he's fellowshipping. It's Sabbath and somebody's sick in his presence. Okay. Verse 7 says, "So the scribes and Pharisees," what? "Watched him closely." Why are they watching him? "Whether he would heal on the Sabbath, that they might find an accusation against him. But he knew their thoughts and said to the man who had the withered hand, 'Arise and stand here.' And he arose and stood. Then Jesus said to them, 'I will ask you one thing. Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or to destroy?' And when he had looked around at them all, he said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' And he did so, and his hand was restored as whole as the other one. But they," this is the religious leaders, Pharisees, "but they were filled with rage and discussed with one another what they might do to Jesus." Go to Luke 13. We're going to see another example of this. Luke 13, chapter 10. "Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of infirmity 18 years and was bent over and could in no way raise herself up. But when Jesus saw her, he called to her and said to her, 'Woman, you are loosed from your infirmity.' And he laid hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. But the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation," he's angry, "because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, and he said to the crowd, 'There are 6 days on which men ought to work. Therefore, come and be healed on one of them, and not on the Sabbath day.' Then the Lord answered him and said, 'Hypocrite, does not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or his donkey from the stall and lead it away to water it? So ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound," think of it, "for 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath?" Listen to this, verse 17. "And when he said these things, all his adversaries were put to shame, and all the multitude rejoiced for all the glorious things which were done by him." So they're watching him. They have planted a sick guy in the house, set that person right before him. So remember what I was saying about the table being like the shape of a U? So I can't prove this biblically, but I would guess that if this guy is sitting right in front of Jesus, then Jesus must be on this side, and the guy might be on the other side of the house because he's sitting before him. So he's in Jesus's line of sight. Jesus can see that a sick person is sitting right in front of him. Jesus discovers very quickly that this is a setup. This is a setup. They have planted a sick person in the house with them
on the Sabbath day, put him right in front of Jesus. The guy's not uninvited. He was invited. He's there for a purpose because they're hoping to trip Jesus up. They're watching Jesus to see what he's going to do. Now, what's he going to do? Is he going to heal the man and give them exactly what they want? A chance to charge him with Sabbath breaking and possibly have him executed for blasphemy, especially if he happens to, again, just like how he did last time, claim that the man's sins are forgiven. They have strategically placed a man with dropsy right in front of Jesus, knowing that Jesus is not gonna, double negative, not gonna not do anything about it, right? Jesus is not going to pass up the opportunity to relieve the suffering of this man, and they know it. They know it. This is a setup. He knows that they have an agenda and that they have carefully set their little trap. Now, we know that he can read their hearts, and we're going to come back to that word in a little bit. And they must at least be curious that he can. So what's he going to do? What is Jesus going to do? Well, the first thing he does is he invites them to dialogue. He invites them to dialogue. So what does he say? Verse 3, and Jesus answering spoke to the lawyers and the Pharisees saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? Now, Jesus invites them to dialogue. He's not going to pass up the opportunity to heal this sick guy. But I want to suggest to you that there's more than one sick person in that room at that time. And here's a little bit of a clue where they're going, where we're going with this. They're all sick with the same disease. They're all sick with the same disease. But before he can get to the issue at hand, before he can heal the man with dropsy, who they placed in front of him, the first thing he has to do is disarm them. Their spider senses are tingling. They are looking for anything, the wrong word. They're looking for any, they're like lions who are crouched down. They're ready to pounce. They're just like, give us a reason. Give us a reason to condemn you. They're watching him to see if he's going to make a mistake. They're counting on him to make a mistake. Their guards are up. You can cut the tension in the room with a knife. All they're waiting for is a word. And he speaks the words, but not what he thought they wanted him to say. So he asked them, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? Why did he ask them these words? Why did he ask this question? I want to suggest to you, he wants them to think. He wants them to reevaluate the situation at hand. He wants them to start searching their knowledge of the law. Remember, these are the Pharisees. They know the law. These are the lawyers. They know the law. Many of these guys have memorized the entire Torah. They have memorized the entire Pentateuch. They know the book of Genesis all the way till the end of Deuteronomy by heart, most of them. So he wants them to start searching their knowledge of the law and to reason that if what he's about to do is lawful or not. That's what he's trying to do, in my opinion. He wants them to start searching their minds to see if he heals this guy, if he's going to be breaking the law, because that's what they're waiting on. They're waiting, they're watching to see if he's going to heal this guy. Now, listen to this quote. This quote is found in a periodical called Signs of the Times. It says, if he had healed the man without closing the mouths of his accusers, they would have once charged him with Sabbath breaking. Wow. Wow. That's interesting to me. So Jesus has correctly read the situation and determined that before he could heal the man, he must first begin to work on the hearts of the other guests. And I want to suggest to you that their case, their sickness, their malady is much more severe. The Bible says that they completely kept silent when Jesus asked them that question. Why did they keep silent? Well, if you remember what the verses that we read in chapter 13, it says, and when he said these things, all his adversaries were put to shame. The reason why they're quiet is because they're feeling ashamed of themselves. They have used this sick guy who has dropsy, which is an incredibly painful disease, as a pawn to try to trip up this young rabbi who seemingly is just going around doing a lot of good. He's going around healing a lot of people. They have been put to shame, and that's why they're quiet. But and before Jesus heals this guy who's sick with the dropsy, he has to first shut them down. He has to disarm them first. The Bible said that they kept silent. They have now been made to see their error, and out of shame, they keep silent. Now, only now, can Jesus heal the man with dropsy. He couldn't do it first because they would have immediately charged him with Sabbath breaking and had him condemned. But he's not done with them. He's not done with them. Again, their sickness, Jesus knows this, is much, much more severe. So it says in verse 4, but they kept silent, and he took him, healed him, and let him go. So the physical dropsy is healed in an instant. Instantly, Jesus grabs him, heals him, lets him go. Instantly, he's healed. The guy leaves the house completely made whole in an instant. Now he begins to work on the guest. And I want to suggest that for them, it's going to take a little bit more time. Listen to this quote. The words of the Lord were as sharp arrows that went to the mark and wounded the hearts of his accusers. Although no human eye could see the flight of the arrow of truth, although no human ear heard the cry of the wounded soul, yet the truth has silently cut its way to the heart. Remember this word. Keep remembering this word. Heart. Jesus is after the heart. This is why he's mingling with them. This is why he's there. He's after their heart. He is constantly trying to find an avenue into the heart. He's developing relationships. He's trying to build trust. He's trying to have a heart to heart with people. He's trying to let people see and sense their need for him. He's looking for a way to get to the heart. He's always looking for a way to the heart. So the guy with dropsy is healed. Now, what's dropsy? What's dropsy? Listen to this from the book Testimonies, Volume 1, which was written in 1859, a woman named Ellen White. This is what she wrote. Listen to this. Disease has pressed heavily upon me. For years, I have been afflicted with dropsy and disease of the heart, which has had a tendency to depress my spirits and destroy my faith and courage. Now, in 1859, this lady said that dropsy was a disease of the heart. Let's see if medical science backs that up almost 170 years later. All right. Dr. Hassan al-Husseini, MD, who's the senior fellow at the East Carolina Heart Institute, this is what he said in his lecture entitled A History of Dropsy. He opens his lecture with these words. My pleasure to be here to talk to you about a very important subject. Dropsy, aka heart failure. Isn't this interesting? Heart failure. So what's dropsy? Dropsy is also called edema. And it can be caused by a few things. So pregnancy can cause dropsy. Some medications can cause dropsy. But the most common cause of dropsy is congestive heart failure, CHF, congestive heart failure. And what happens is that your heart is failing and it's too weak to properly circulate the blood. And so it adds a stress hormone to increase the speed of your heart rate. And your blood pressure goes up. And then what happens is your extremities and sometimes even your abdomen start swelling with fluids. The heart is failing, okay? Your extremities start swelling with, and the blood and the fluids become stagnant. It's incredibly, incredibly painful. If you've ever seen somebody who has these compression sleeves on or these compression socks, dropsy. The heart is working really, really hard, and it can't properly circulate the blood, so the fluid begins to gather in your extremities and sometimes even in your abdomen. Now, the heart is failing. This is what dropsy is, congestive heart failure, okay? Now, There was a man at this feast who had dropsy. I want to suggest to you that he wasn't pregnant and that he wasn't on medication, that and there's other possible causes for dropsy. He could have been eating so too much salt or something. And here's a little the side nugget that really has nothing to do with our talk, but you know what the main cure is for dropsy? Lifestyle changes. Lifestyle changes. So I want to suggest to you that this guy was suffering from congestive heart failure. His heart was failing. His heart was failing. So it's also interesting that the word dropsy is only used one time in the entire Bible, and it's used right here in Luke 14 in our text by Luke, who was a physician. So he knew what he was talking about. I also want to suggest to you that the guests and the host at this feast are suffering from the same illness, spiritual heart failure, spiritual dropsy. Their lack of compassion for the sick was making their spiritual lifeblood stagnant. Their sense of national pride and the amount of stress that they were putting on themselves and on others by their traditions was making their extremities swell with pride. They had lost the ability to be merciful. They were disconnected from the people that they were supposed to help. And in reality, though they didn't know it, they were disconnected from God. Their weak hearts were failing them. And just like Jesus healed the man who had physical dropsy in a touch, he also wants to heal them. He also wants to heal them. Listen to this text, this quote. This is found from a periodical called the Review and Herald from the year 1896. Listen to this. It says, the religious leaders of the Jewish nation were zealous in their professions of godliness while they refused to be doers of the word of God. So Jesus correctly reads this situation. He understands that in order for him to heal the man, he had to disarm them because of their prejudice, because of their pride, because of their conniving and their plotting. So he shuts them down. He heals the man. Now he begins to go to work on them. And his words are starting to have an effect on them. You could tell because they're quiet. They're not saying anything. He asked them a legitimate question. Is it lawful for me to heal on the Sabbath day? They didn't say nothing. They're ashamed. They're thinking. They're in their heads right now. He heals the guy, lets the guy go, and they all remain silent. They're thinking. They're thinking. Remember this that text that we read a little while ago. It said, no one can say that the arrow of truth has not sped to the mark and pierced the souls of those who are listening to Jesus. Although no human eye could see the flight of the arrow of truth, although no human ear heard the cry of the wounded soul, yet the truth has silently cut its way to the heart. Jesus is after their hearts. He is trying to heal their pride and their presumption. They just have this sense of national pride, somehow the fact that they're Israelites, and the fact that they're of Israel, and the fact that they're religious leaders, or they're Pharisees, and they're teachers of the law, that somehow this alone recommends them to God. And you remember a story when they came to John the Baptist, and John the Baptist basically told him, he said, don't even think that. Don't start to think that we have Abraham as our father is going to be your get out of jail free card, because I'm telling you, God can raise up children to Abraham from these very stones. And then John goes on to say, and now the axe is laid to the root of the tree. Well, what was the tree? The tree was this idea that your Jewishness, the fact that you are a physical descendant, a genetic descendant, a direct physical descendant of Abraham, recommended you to God. That you didn't have nothing else to do. You were a Jew. So by default, you are already in heaven. You already made it. So their hearts are weak, and Jesus is trying to heal their pride and their presumption. It's almost like the message in Revelation to the church of Laodicea, that think you think you're rich and you're in need of nothing, but I know your works. You've judged yourself worthy and you have a really high opinion of yourself, but you're wrong. I know that you're wretched, you're miserable, you're cold, you're blind, and you're naked. I know your works. It's pride and it's presumption. Let's continue with our text. Let's continue with our text. So they kept silent. Then Jesus answered them, saying, which one of you having a donkey or an ox that has fallen into a pit will not immediately pull him out on the Sabbath day? And they could answer him nothing regarding these things. Now let's go to verse 7. Then he told a parable to those who were invited, when he noted how they chose the best places, saying to them, when you're invited by anyone to a wedding feast, do not sit down in the best place, lest one more honorable than you be invited by him. And he who invited you come, you and him come and say to you, give place to this man. And then you begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you're invited, go and sit down in the lowest place, so that when he who invited you comes, he may say to you, friend, go up higher. Then you will have glory in the presence of those who sit at the table with you. For whoever exalts himself will be humble, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. All right, so now he's starting to deal with the guests, and he's telling them, look, it's pride and presumption that seeks out the best seats when you were never invited to do so. There's another more worthy than you, who's the latchets of whose shoes you're not even worthy to untie. Okay, you guys think that you're going to come in here and you're going to go up to the, and you're going to just assume that you're going to be the most honored person at this table, at this feast. He says, go to the lowest spot. Challenge yourself to go to the lowest spot. I know you got to try real hard to do it, because your nature wants to go sit right next to the host, because you think that that's where you belong. But if someone more honorable comes, he's going to tell you to move, and that's going to be embarrassing for you, man. Go to the lowest spot and have him call you up. So he's starting to work on the hearts of the guests now. He's dealt with the guy with dropsy. Now he's working on the heart of the guests. Okay? He's working on the hearts of the guests, and he's telling them, your heart is failing you. You think that you're going to be the most honored person, and again, it's pride and presumption that seeks out the best seats when you were never invited to do so. There's another more worthy than you. John, there's another more worthy than you. AFY, there's another more worried than you. Laodicea, Jewish leaders, there's another more worthy than you. Your heart is failing. I know your works, but I'm able to heal your failing heart. Now, let's go to verse 12. Now he's done with the guests. Now he's going to start dealing with the host as well. Remember, he's after the heart. Jesus is after the heart. Listen to what he says in verse 12. Then he also said to him who invited him, so this is the host, when you give a dinner or a supper, do not ask your friends, your brothers, your relatives, nor your rich neighbors, lest they also invite you back and you be repaid. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind. Remember, I said we were going to come back to that. And you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you shall be repaid at the resurrection of the just. All right, he's done with the guests. Now he's starting to deal with the host, and he's going after the heart. All right, he tells the host, when you invite people, so he tells the guests, when you're invited, don't go sit straight next to the host. Don't go take the most honorable seat. Go and take the lowest seat. And if the guest wants you to come up higher, leave that up to the host if he wants you to come up higher. But don't you automatically just assume that you're going to be the most honored person there, okay? Now he's dealing with the guests. He's saying, you, when you invite people, don't invite all of your rich friends that you want to owe you one, because all they're going to do is make a feast, call you, invite you back, and you're repaid. Instead, invite people who could never pay you back. You know, my mom used to say one time, She told me, you know, you could tell a lot about somebody by how they treat people who can't do nothing for them. People who can't pay them back. People who they feel can't contribute anything to their life. You could tell a whole lot about someone by how they treat others who have nothing to offer them. And I think my mom was right. Jesus is saying that you only invited those who you want to owe you one. So in a sense, you're not doing any good to anyone but yourself. Invite some folk who could never invite you back to a spread like the one you provided, and you will actually receive a greater reward at the resurrection of the just. And when you get repaid for what you do for others, you lose the joy that can only come from being truly generous. All right? He's after the heart. He's after the heart. So you've ever heard somebody, people that come up to you, they want to give you something, and they'd be like, you'd be like, yeah, I need something. I need this. I need a toaster or whatever. Just fill in the blank. I need this. And somebody would say, oh, no, I got one. I go here. You can have it. Oh, no, no, no. I'm going to go get one. No, no, no. Here, take it. Take it. No, no, I'm going to go buy one. No. Don't block my blessing. They say, don't block my blessing. It is crazy. It's like, okay, so you giving me this toaster because you want God to bless you back? So it's like it's transactional, or is there the motive here that you recognize that you're selfish and you desperately want to be more like Jesus, and that's why you're doing it? So is that what God is to you? Like a transaction? Like, God, look, I gave her a toaster, now give me a new car. So those are two different things. Those are two different things. Now, let's go to verse 15. Now, Jesus has dealt with the guests. He's dealt with the host. And now in verse 15, listen to this. Now, when one of those who sat at the table, now we don't know if this is the host who said this or one of the guests, but one of the guys says, blessed is he who shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. And we all say, amen, amen. At least one of the guests, we can tell from the text, is pricked. And he speaks. I want to suggest to you that this guy is not speaking because he agrees with Jesus, okay? He's not speaking because he's pricked. He wants Jesus to change the subject from talking about what's going on in his own individual heart to, and let's change the subject to some vague general topic. Oh, yeah, the resurrection of the just in the future, sometime in the future when the blessed are going to eat bread in the kingdom of God. Let's talk about that, Jesus, instead, because I'm getting mighty uncomfortable around you, Jesus, talking about all of these stuff that is going on in my heart. He wants to change the subject from to talking about anything but what's going on in his own heart. He wants Jesus to get off his back. And in so doing, he displays the very symptom of his failing heart. For one, he assumed that he was going to be in God's kingdom, eating bread while he's trying to set up the king himself, while he's full of hate for the king himself who's sitting in front of him. One of their number had declared that those who ate bread in the kingdom of God would be blessed. But at the same time, they were all refusing the invitation to the feast that had been prepared for them. Isn't this interesting? And it's in this context, that context, that Jesus gives this parable. So the guy says, blessed are they who are going to eat bread in the kingdom of God. And I imagine Jesus looks at him like, really? Verse 16, a certain man made a great supper and invited many and sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were invited, come, for all things are now ready. But they all with one accord began to make excuses. The first said to him, I have bought a piece of ground and I must go and see it. I ask you to have me excused. And another said, I bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going to test them. I ask you to have me excused. Still another said, I've married a wife and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and reported these things to his master. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. And the servant said, Master, it is done as you commanded, and still there is room. Then the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come. I want that my house may be filled. For I say unto you that none of those men who were invited shall taste my supper. Isn't this interesting? So there's two interpretations to this prophecy, to this parable. One of them is prophetic, and the other one is spiritual. Let's deal with the prophetic first, okay? So the first invitation, it's interesting to know, when Jesus gives this parable to them, they know that he's talking about them. They know he's talking about them. So what is the prophetic interpretation of this parable? First, listen to this quote, Review and Herald. Those who were sitting at the table, this is Review and Herald 1896. Those who were sitting at the table understood the parable and knew that their cases were represented by the different classes who began to make excuse. Okay. So the first invitation, which is implied in the text, it's implied in the text. The first invitation to the religious leader, to the nation of Israel, the first invitation is given to them by the old prophet, the Old Testament prophets. That's the first invitation that's given. The second invitation, when everything was ready, was given to them in the ministry of John the Baptist. And if you go to a Review and Herald, March 3rd, for the sake of time, I won't read too many more of those, but Review and Herald, March 3rd, 1896, you can see that this is very, very clear that the first invitation is implied, and it was the invitation given to the nation of Israel through Moses and through the prophets. Remember, all that the Lord has said, we will do. The Old Testament prophets. The second was John's invitation to them when John started coming, ministering to them, saying, the Messiah is coming. He's almost here. But since they made their worldly pursuits. So the first guy, he says, I have bought some land, so I can't come. I need you to think about this. Think about this for a second. Listen to the excuses. Now, this guy has gone through a lot to prepare this feast. He's gone through a lot to prepare this feast. And one by one, they start making excuses as to why they can't go. He's very, very angry, as he should be. He should be angry. Imagine that you go through all of the trouble to put together this huge feast for your friends, and every single one of them RSVPs. This is why the first invitation is implied. This guy didn't cook all of this stuff and start looking for people to come. They said that they were going to be there. Okay? So, day of the feast comes. Everything is ready. He's looking around. He's probably checking his phone to see, hey, maybe there's some traffic in the area. No one has called. A messenger hasn't come saying that they're not going to be able to make it. I said 3 o'clock. What's going on? Why are they not here? He starts calling them one by one. And they're making excuses. They are making their worldly pursuits and their personal interests of more value than the call of God to attend this feast. They are completely rejecting the Messiah that they claimed that they've been waiting for. And in Matthew chapter 21, verse 31, Jesus tells another parable where he says, a landowner sent his two sons to go work in the field. The first one said, I'm not going, but he went. The second one said, I'm not going. I am going, but I'm not going. And he asked them, which one of these sons did the will of their father? And they correctly answered, the one who said he was the one who went and did it. And Jesus immediately behind that says, you know, tax collectors and prostitutes. He's speaking to the religious leaders. He said, tax collectors and prostitutes go into the kingdom before you. So the first invitation is to the religious leaders. The second invitation is to the tax collectors, the prostitutes, anyone and everyone who wants it, but out of the people in Jerusalem. And the third invitation is to the Gentiles. These are prophetic, and this is going to become important in a little bit. The first invitation is to the elite of Israel, the religious leaders, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the lawyers, those who were the teachers of Israel, the men with influence. The next invitation, tax collectors, publicans, anyone from Israel. It had to go to Israel first. As a matter of fact, in Acts chapter 13, Paul and Barnabas, it says in Acts chapter 13, verse 46, that Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you. And they're speaking to religious leaders. But seeing that you put it far from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, look, we turn to the Gentiles. The message had to go to the Israelites first, and it had to go to the religious leaders first. Then it went to Israel, and once they rejected it, once they rejected Messiah, then it went to the Gentiles. We have to set that up so that I can now bring out the spiritual implications of this. So he makes a feast. Now let's talk about the spiritual application of this parable. He makes a feast. He's very angry. He calls the first guy, and the guy's like, yeah, man, I'm sorry. I bought a house, and I got to go look at it. He's like, what? You bought a house, man? I mean, don't you realize I had to sacrifice animals in it? The guy said, yeah, sorry, I can't make it. Please have me excused. So he hangs up, and he can already feel his blood pressure starting to go up a little bit. But it's like, all right, well. And he calls the second guy, and the guy's like, hey, yeah, sorry, I can't come, man. I bought a truck, and I got to go make sure it runs. So I'm not going to be, what you mean you got to go make sure it runs? You didn't make sure it ran before you bought. Whatever. All right. Third guy says, yeah, man, I got married. My old lady won't let me go. He is. Even today, this would be highly, highly disrespectful. Okay? In those days, it was unthinkable that somebody would do this, that somebody would go through all of the trouble. He again, it might have been around the harvest time. So he's all of his first fruits and everything he's bringing in there. He created this big feast. He might have had to sacrifice animals to do this. It would have been unthinkable for someone to just not show up and give these flimsy, lazy, lame excuses for why they couldn't go. Man, I mean, you better had a really, really good excuse as to why you couldn't make it. I mean, it wasn't like living today where there's always something going on to pull your attention. I mean, what else are you gonna do in Jerusalem on the day of a big feast? No, you want to be there, because otherwise life is gonna be boring. Just over here sitting at your house going to look at property. Come on, man. These excuses were lame, and he knew it, and he's angry. He's angry about it. So instead of him doing what some people would do, and I will hope nobody here would do it, but instead of him throwing all the food away and say, you know what, throw it all away, and writing every single one of them off, he doesn't do that, and I would hope none of us would do that either. What he does is he gives the servant another order. He says, okay, the people that I invited don't want to be here. They don't want nothing to do with me. They have disrespected me in a very, very big way to my very face. They have shown me by some of these lame excuses that they don't like my company. They don't appreciate what I've done for them. They don't want my love. They don't want a relationship with me, because basically what they have done is it's ain't no coming back from what they've done. Okay. It's very, very disrespectful what they've done. He says, you know what? Verse 13. I'm sorry, not verse 13. He says in verse 21, So that servant came and reported these things to his master, that the guys ain't coming. Then the master of the house, being very angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. This landowner that made the feast represents Christ. You know how we know he represents Christ? Because in verse 13, the landowner does the same thing that Christ told the host to do. You remember he said in verse 13, but when you give a feast, invite the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind. The same thing that Jesus told the host to do is what this landowner is doing. Go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city, and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. Now, since we've already studied the prophetic application of this parable, you remember the first invitation was to the religious elite. This part of this second invitation is to the publicans, the harlots, the broke, the lepers, the poor, the sick, the peasants, the worthless, the people were ostracized, but from Israel, the Israelites, the Jews who were ostracized from society, the Jews who were on the outskirts, the Jews who weren't popular, the Jews who the Pharisees and everybody else looked down on with disdain. He says, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. So the first time that the servant goes out, it's to the streets and the lanes of the city, looking for anyone who was in need, because those are going to be the ones who need it most. And they were the ones who were closest. The lanes and the alleys where the poor and the rabble would hang out. That's where the servant is going now. The owner wants to make sure that anyone in the area who wants to be at the banquet, the servant is ordered to turn no one down. Invite anyone and everyone from the city who is hungry. Every one of them are welcome to come in. Bring in everyone that you find. Remember, the message had to go to the Jews first. So this is Jesus saying, anyone who's of the Jews, if you're a leper, you're welcome. If you're a tax collector, you're welcome. If you're a publican, you're welcome. If you're a harlot, you're welcome. If you're sick with dropsy, you're welcome. Everyone who is looked down on by the religious leaders, since the religious leaders don't want nothing to do with me, everyone who wants it can have it in the city. Now, in verse 21, at the end of verse 22, and the servant said, master, it is done. So after all of the people from the inside the city were invited, verse 22, the servant said, master, it is done as you have commanded, and still there is room. Now, verse 23, then the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. This group is a little different. When you get to the highways and the hedges, you're dealing with people who are outside of the city. This represents the Gentiles, or specifically the Gentile travelers and the poor who weren't allowed in the city. It also represents those who were working and who in many times lived amongst the hedges. Now, what were the hedges? The hedges were the walls of partition that separated the inside of the vineyard from the outside of the vineyard. And the hedge was the protection that kept people and animals and things that they didn't want to get inside of the vineyard. The hedge protected the vineyard from what was outside of the vineyard, okay? And there were people who worked amongst those hedges and kept those hedges, and in many cases, they lived amongst these hedges. And the landowner said, go to the highways and go to the hedges. Go to the Gentiles. Go to the people who are outside of the wall, separated from the vineyard. Go to them and compel them to come in. Now, the first group in verse 21, he says, go out quickly into the streets and lanes and bring in here the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind. In verse 23, he says, go out into the highways and the hedges, representing the Gentiles, and compel them to come in. Now, ask yourself a question. Is there a difference between bring and compel? Yeah, there's a difference. But the way that the word compel is used today, it usually means force. Force. Now, God never forces anyone at all to come to him. So this word compel has been used by some to teach doctrines about God and about the character of God that are not taught in the Bible. The idea that God chooses who's going to be saved and God forces people to be saved. There's this idea called irresistible grace that God forces and God chooses who is going to be saved. That you have nothing to say in the matter. You have no say. You have nothing to do in this matter. That it's God who chooses who's going to be saved. But God offers everyone a choice, whether they want to serve him or not. So why the word compel? I want to suggest to you that the word compel is perhaps not the best word. This group, which represents the Gentiles, needs to be convinced. Okay? This group is likely to laugh in the face of the servant when he goes and says, hey, you're invited to a great big feast. Everything is going to be provided. They're likely to laugh at that servant or to accuse him of mocking them by inviting them to go into a city that they've never been invited to before, into a city that they've never been welcome here before. Keep paying attention because there's tons of spiritual applications in this right now. This group is likely to laugh and to accuse the servant of mocking them, of looking at them in their distress and their depressing state and inviting them to go into a city that they've never been welcomed to. Think about evangelism. Go to a city that they've never been invited to, a place that they've never been welcomed to a great banquet. These people have never been welcomed to the house of anyone in that city at all. And the suggestion that somehow now they're going to be welcome, it's going to take some convincing. It's going to take some convincing. The master of the house says to his servant, go and take no excuses from those amongst the hedges about how filthy they are, about how unfit they are, about how they don't have the proper attire, about how they could never attend such a feast in such a dirty condition as they are, about how sweaty and how nasty they are, how unworthy of a guest that they would be at my feast. Take no excuses about that. You urge them to come. You tell them that it's urgent that they come. And if they come, promise them that I will in no wise cast them out. You tell them that I will accept them just as they are. You tell them that I will provide whatever they need. Just come. You compel them to come. You urge them to come. You tell them that it's urgent that they come. You be patient with them now because they're not used to being invited to a feast of this caliber. You treat them with love and with dignity because they've been abused and they've been unwelcome, and it's going to take some work. It's going to take some convincing. It's going to take some urging for them to believe that I really want them to come to my house. But don't you take no for an answer. Don't force them, because if I was going to force anybody, I was going to force the ones who I invited that rejected my invitation. But you urge them to come. You overcome their reluctance to want to come with evidence of my strong desire to see them in my house at my feast. You urge them to come. You tell them that it's urgent that they come. I want my house full. I have bread and wine to spare. I will cover them with a clean robe. Everything that they need, I will give them if they come. If they come. What's interesting is that the word compel or urge or convince, that's used in verse 23 is the exact same word used in verse 18. You remember when the feast was ready in verse 17, and he sent his servant to the supper time to tell all of those invited to come, for all things were now ready. But they all, verse 18, with one accord began to make excuses. And you remember what the first one said? The first one said, I have bought a piece of ground and I must go see it. I really, really, really have to go see it. The King James says, I must needs go see it. Like, I really, really, really need to go look at my land. Do you remember that? Same exact word as compel, except one difference. The word compel that's used in verse 23, for those amongst the highways and the hedges, those who are on the outcasts of society, those who have never been invited into that city, those who have never been welcomed in that city, those who have never been, it's unthinkable that they would ever be invited to a house of anyone in that city. That word compel is a much stronger version of the same word that the word that was used to reject the invitation of the master. Now, what does that mean? This is what I think that means. I believe that this means that the love of God pursues us with a love that is stronger than I could ever reject him. I'm going to say that again. The love of God pursues me stronger than I could ever reject him. That's what I think that means. That's what I think that means. Now, did they get it? Do you think they got it? Do you think that the guests and the hosts that were listening to Jesus' story, do you think they got it? Well, I want to suggest to you that it really doesn't matter if they got it or not. Do we get it? Do we somehow feel like we are super Christians while we look down at all of the other Christians that don't have the truth? They don't have the diet. They don't worship on the day that we worship on. They don't understand the prophecies the way that we do. I've been thinking a lot about evangelism lately, and I want to kind of tie this into evangelism. And I want to ask you, what if someone comes to our church one day, and this is where we're going to finish up, and you're greeting, and that person comes to the church, and you can smell, man, they smell like they might have just smoked a joint or a cigarette, or maybe you smell some alcohol on their breath. What if a dude shows up and his head is shaved and his entire head is shaved, and it's only because his entire head is a tattoo that goes down his neck and down his arm and down his legs, and he's wearing shorts and he's dressed in all black and he's got more piercing in his ears and nose and lips? But what if a guy shows up in high heels and he's wearing a dress? Or what if a woman shows up in high heels and she's wearing a dress that is leaving not too much to the imagination? Or what if a woman shows up and she's got one black eye and a busted lip? What if two guys show up holding hands? What if? How will we respond to those situations? How would I respond to those situations? Would I have the heart of God that says, you urge them to come? You don't get in the way of what I'm trying to do in my life. You understand that it takes a lot of courage for them to come. You understand that they've never felt welcome to a feast like this, that they've been on the outskirts for their entire lives, that they've never been invited to any kind of feast like this. You understand that it's going to take some convincing, some urging for them to even feel like I even really want them to be at my feast. Title of the talk is Spiritual Dropsy. The guests, the hosts, they were sick with spiritual heart failure. Their pride their presumption was causing them to swell up so much. They didn't see was one touch from the master could have set them free and could have healed them, just like the guy with physical dropsy was healed in a touch, in an instant. Their spiritual dropsy could have been healed as well, in an instant. And I'm wondering, how is it with you? How is it with me? I want to tell you that I need a touch from the master. And if you need a touch with the, from the master as well, if you sense that your heart might be failing, then I just want to invite you to pray with me. Our Father and our God, we just want to thank you so much for your word that is a light unto our feet. Your word, Father God, that teaches us how to walk, how to talk, how to treat people. Your word, Father God, that transforms us from the inside out, Father God. Your word that begins to mold us after your own beautiful character. Your word that tells us about Jesus. And as we read it, as we internalize it, as we fall more deeply in love with you, we only pray that we will begin to reflect his heart of love, and that it will be seen most in how we treat others, and how we choose to live our lives, Father God, and how we share the beautiful message of salvation that you've given to us, not so that we can hoard it, not so that we can keep it to ourselves, but so that we can share it with the entire world. There are people all around us, Father God, who are suffering and who are dying, who are depressed, who no one will probably ever think to go try to share the gospel with because of how they look or how they dress or how they live or where they live or where they work, how they talk. And yet, if you were here today, Father God, I'm strangely suspicious that that's exactly where you would be. Give us a heart for people and give us the courage to go for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for having me tonight, guys. I love you guys. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for being consistent. Thank you for being amazing youth. God bless you all.
Thank you, Brother Basco. Would you have any time for us to be able to do Q&A after the special music?
Yeah, I can stick around for a few minutes.
All right, cool. All right, let me get the special music up. And while the music is playing, you guys can get your questions ready. Get this going. Thank you so much for that, Andrew. I'm not seeing any questions on my end. I don't know if anybody sent any to you.
Let me see. Eliana said, where did you find the info about the U-shaped table and the seating based on the importance of the person? All right, let me see. Eliana, I saw that on Google, and I don't remember what site, but I tell you what, I'll look it up again. And I was just researching how Jewish, let me just, Jewish feasts, table arrangement. Let's see if that worked. Let's see. Images. Maybe I put ancient. It may have been in one of the commentaries that I looked into when I was. Okay. This is on my computer, but if you Google ancient Jewish feasts table arrangement, it'll show you a bunch of tables of a bunch of pictures of this U shape. And you just gotta maybe click on one of those pictures or and then read up a little bit about it. Seven sacred animal feasts of the Old Covenant, setting of the Last Supper, Jewish feasts and festivals. So yeah, I found it in one of the commentaries that I was reading when I was researching this parable. And I can't tell you exactly what site, but I'm pretty sure if you just Google ancient Jewish feasts table arrangement, you'll be able to find that. I'm sorry, I don't have that exact reference for you, but I'll take a look at it, and maybe I'll send it to Edward, who is the person I've been communicating with. Or the next time I'm on here, if you're there, then I promise I'll have that information for you guys then. That's the only question that I got. You got it? Hey, no problem, Eliana. God bless. You're in California, so it's just about Sabbath time for you. Happy Sabbath. Sabbath is here. Praise the Lord. We made it through another week. So, any other questions? Hey, thanks. Same to you, Eliana.
I didn't get any on my end, so that's
All right.
probably it. Well,
All right. Well, thank you guys so much for having me, and just stay
yeah,
in
but I
prayer,
have a
stay in the
question,
word.
Brother Russell.
Yeah,
Roy's got a
sure. Hey,
question.
Roy, how you doing?
I'm good, praise God.
Amen, amen. Good to see you.
Yeah, can I ask regarding do you have any practical advice or how to reach out those bisexual brethren in the church, you know, not so much of having prejudice, but you know, sharing the love of Jesus to them.
Let me go back to my slides, okay? I want to read something for you. Roy, I'm going to give you a quote. I'm going to give you some homework too. Not just you. I need to do this same homework. Everyone here needs to do this same homework, okay? Let me look for my slides, and I'm going to give you a quote from the book Ministry of Healing, page 143. Ministry of Healing, page 143. So think about this. The numeric value of the word, the phrase "I love you" is 143, right? If you ever like, I'm older than you guys, a lot of you guys. So we used to have beepers, and a beeper was before cell phones. Basically, it was a little box. And if someone needed to get in touch with you, they would call your beeper and they would leave you a code, like a phone number or something. Well, we got pretty creative. So if someone left you the code 143, it meant I love you. I has one letter, love has four letters, you has three letters. So 143. Ministry of Healing, 143. Ministry of Healing, I love you. Listen to the quote. Memorize this quote. Internalize this quote. It says, Christ's method alone will give true success in reaching the people, any people. It just says the people. So this applies to anyone, to bisexual, to homosexual, to transsexual, to addicted,
to people who have been abused sexually, people who have been abused physically and emotionally, people who are divorced, people who feel lost, depressed. Man, look, people around us are dealing with all kinds of things that we don't always see. Even people who may come to church and say, Happy Sabbath, and you put on a smile, and you never really realize, they ever think that anything is going on with them. We don't know. We don't know what's happening in someone's heart. But the quote says, and it's great, great advice, and it's, in my opinion, the only method that will work to reach anyone, to reach anyone. Christ's method alone will give true success in reaching the people. The Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. So when you're meeting with someone who is living a lifestyle that you may not agree with, so there's another place that that the author of this quote says that it would be good, and I don't have this reference. I know it's in Review and Herald, I think 1896, March 1896, but I'm not sure. And I will look because I've been looking for it. Someone else asked me for it and I still haven't found it, but I read it. I know it's there, where she says that it would be good for Christians to visit places that they probably normally wouldn't go if they can go there and be a light. So I don't think what she's saying is go hang out at the bar so that you can reach people who are drinking alcohol. That's not what I'm thinking. I don't think she's saying that. But what she may be saying is, as long as in principle, there's nothing wrong with going to this place. For example, when I first came back to the Lord and got rebaptized in the church, my family, who was not a member of my denomination, don't follow the same health principles that I do, don't follow the same diet that I do. It was Easter. It was Good Friday, and they were having I'm from Louisiana, so they were having a crawfish boil. And if you know what crawfish are, it's like little lobsters. I don't eat them. I used to eat them, but I don't eat them anymore. And this was after, so the year before I probably went. After I came to Christ, I didn't want to go. I was like, no, they're going to be serving sausage, pork sausage, and I don't eat that. And they're going to be serving catfish and I don't eat that, and they're gonna have shrimp and I don't eat that, and they're gonna have crawfish and I don't eat that. I'm not going because I don't want to be tempted. And the elder of my church, he was like, so are you going by your mom and them? It's like, no, I'm wrestling, man. I don't want to be tempted, and I don't think that's a good environment for me to go. It would be like, you know, it's Christmas at the families, or it's Thanksgiving here in the States at the families, but they're going to be drinking alcohol, so I'm not going to go. Ellen White says it would be good for us to go if we can go with the right motive, that we want to be a light in that situation and not feel like, no, I, by my absence, is going to show that I am protesting against their life choices. I am protesting against their choices of diet, of their choices of drink, of their choices of behavior. Now, look, it would be a little bit different now because I'm a new father. I have a baby now. So maybe I don't know if they're jamming music too loud, or maybe I'll go for a little while and just to show my face and show my presence, to be a light in that situation. But I won't stay too long, especially once the alcohol starts kicking in and they get a little antsy and everything. But she says that it would be good for us to go if our motives are right, and if we can be a light in that situation and not be a distraction, it would be good for us to go. She says that in one of the quotes. So the Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. He showed his sympathy for them. He ministered to their needs and won their confidence. Then, and only then, did he bid them to follow me. So you asked, Roy, for practical advice on how to reach someone who is living an alternative lifestyle or following principles that you don't and perhaps I don't as well believe that the Bible teaches. Should we stay away from these people? Should we ostracize these people? Should we keep these people at arm's length and say, hey, you know, you got to kind of stop living that lifestyle before I allow you into my little circle here. Well, is that what God does with us? Oh, he doesn't. He doesn't. So what's some practical advice? Be a friend. Be a friend. Develop a relationship. Once you develop a relationship with someone, and you got to be smart with this too. You got to be smart because, you know, many times if you get too close to somebody who is living some crazy lifestyle, in many cases, they can drag you in to their mess instead of you dragging them out of it. So you got to be careful. You got to be smart. You got to have tact. You got to be loving. But at the same time, you have to be smart. So develop a relationship, show sympathy for them. Listen to what they're saying. Try to understand try to get in their head and understand why it is that they're living this lifestyle that goes against the Bible and goes against the principles that God has espoused. But they're not going to hear anything that you have to say. A friend of mine loves to say this quote, and it's so true. People don't care what you know until they know how much you care. Until someone knows how much you care about them, that you genuinely care about them, that you want the best for them, it doesn't matter what you tell them. But once you have built trust, once you have built a relationship with them, then you can start sharing the love of Christ with them. And in fact, you've already been sharing the love of Christ with them, because most people who are living these alternative lifestyles, they are so used to Christians wanting nothing to do with them. They're so used to Christians shunning them and pushing them to the side, and Christians saying, no, I don't want you around me. I don't want you around my family. I don't want you around my kids, because what you have might rub off on them. Oh, man, no. In my opinion, that's not the best way. That's not the best way. Be a friend. Develop a relationship and trust that the Holy Spirit is going to tell you when it's time for you to start sharing the deeper things of the law and of the love of Christ with them, and pray for them, man. These are practical things that you can do. You could pray for that person, like intentionally pray for that person. Pray for them by name. Pray for them. Set an alarm that, look, I'm going to pray every time this alarm goes off, whatever I'm doing, I'm going to stop and I'm going to pray for this person. God can work in the life of somebody more easily if somebody is actually praying for them. As a matter of fact, in another quote, And I hate to just keep on quoting the Spirit of Prophecy, but she has so many good quotes. She says there's things that God can do in the life of someone that he couldn't normally do if someone wasn't praying for that person. So by praying for that person, you're giving God permission to work in their lives. So here's some practical things. Be a friend, listen, and pray for them. Pray for them. Just be a friend. Develop a relationship. That's the best advice that I have, and it's the advice that I followed, and it's worked, man. There's some people that we're still working on. As a matter of fact, somebody very, very, very close to me, somebody I love very much, close to my wife, is in one of these alternative lifestyles, and they're dealing with it. In my family, someone in my family is dealing with it, and it breaks our hearts. It really breaks our hearts. And you know, this is somebody who was very, very strong in the church at some point. And now they want nothing to do with God, and they, in many cases, don't want to hear nothing that we have to say, but we're praying and we're just showing them love and then trusting that God, according to Philippians 1:6, is going to finish the work that he starts, and not only them, and every single one of us. I hope that answers your question, man.
All right, thank you for your time, Brother Basco. But before we end the stream, Uncle Tony sent us a quick message he wanted to share with us. Unless anybody else has a question before I do this, does anybody have any more questions? No questions? Okay. All right. Your sound. Yeah, maximizes.
Amazing facts, youth. Here's an amazing fact for you. I just drove around a partial part of Lake Tahoe, deepest lake west of the Mississippi. One of the largest lakes, but not the largest lake. Excuse me, there's a big truck coming alongside me here. Another amazing fact, I'm driving in a convertible. My hair is all nicely messy because of the wind. But currently, I'm driving through Carson City. And I just wanted to share with you what a blessing all of you are. And I'm praying for each of you. You are a very special group of young people that somewhere, someway, somehow, God has interjected our lives, but mostly amazing facts. Go to amazingfacts.org. Go to any one of the websites. There's 53 of them. There's free books. There's a free library. There's free videos. There's free booklets. There's free everything. Study to show yourself approved unto God. Yeah, that's an amazing fact. So y'all have a great night tonight. God bless you, and I'll see you guys really soon.
Quick question, Uncle Tony. So
that is a Josiah. Yes, he was in a convertible. I'm jealous. He was in a convertible in Lake Tahoe, and I'm in an office in New Orleans. So. I'm going to text him and say, hey, come on, man.
Yeah, he's lucky.
Yeah, that was
awesome. Looks like it's nice weather, too.
Yeah, I know, right?
All right, well.
Clara said that, Roy, by the way, memorize that quote, memorize that paragraph. But Clara would like to give us the advice that we actually go to the paragraph before that and start reading from there. It's not normally included. Usually people, when they quote Ministry of Healing 143, they start with the words Christ Method alone. But Clara said, no, go back a little bit more because it's actually much more beautiful. Hey, Clara, go ahead.
I'm sorry. It's so Christ Method alone is Ministry of Healing 143, paragraph 3, and then the next line of paragraph 4 is the one that I was referring to.
Thanks for the clarification.
All right. Thank you, Brother Basco, for the message tonight. We'll now have our opening prayer by Josue. Josue, would you like to do that, please?
Okay, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful message that we heard. I ask that you help us to not only hear the message, but to apply it to our own lives and be able to be able to apply it to our lives. I ask that you be with us the rest of this afternoon or day, whatever time it may be for those who are watching this and all the activities that we do on this Sabbath. And I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Goodbye for those of you on YouTube. We hope to see you next Friday.